move on to our program now then. Our guest speaker tonight is a gentleman who's had many years telling the public about the American Chestnut Foundation and its work to revitalize this giant of our hardwood forests, the American Chestnut. Retired wildlife biologist Kurt Laffin will trace the history of this significant tree, which has been so badly affected by the fungus disease called chestnut blight. And Mr. Laffin, who is brother-in-law of our board member, Paul Dick, became intrigued by this loss of the trees when at the age of five, his father showed him one of the last surviving significant American chestnuts in Harvard, Mass. Kurt's retired from the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, and he's volunteered for 10 years as a speaker for the American Chestnut Foundation, giving talks throughout New England. So he's also a volunteer for the Merrimack River Watershed Council. So welcome, Mr. Laffin.
Thank you. Okay, well, thank you very much for inviting me. First thing I have to do is get a little administrative item out of the way. I'm going to be talking about the American Chestnut Foundation. We're a national organization, but we're organized into state chapters. And I'm a volunteer with the Vermont, New Hampshire chapter, so I'm a little out of my territory, but I cooperate with the Mass Rhode Island chapter. And if somebody wants a speaker in the eastern part of Massachusetts, I often come down and do it. And what I usually have to say is that if you have any questions specific about what's going on in Massachusetts, I'll refer you to some folks you have to get in touch with. But you're a very fortunate audience tonight, because we have Lois and Dennis Melikin sitting in the back here, who are very active with the Massachusetts chapter. So if any questions come up about... Yes, I can.
And have them stand up.
Okay, yeah, Lois and Dennis, I think they're in the back. Do you want to just, well, she can't stand up. She has a cast on her foot. Okay, so get that out of the way so that, it'll make a lot more sense to you later on in the talk about how we're organized by state chapters. And as you just heard, I first got involved with interested in the American chestnut tree when I was about 5 years old. And my father did show me a tree in Harvard that he said was the last living American chestnut that he was aware of. And I've always been interested in natural resources and the outdoors, and I pursued a career in wildlife science. So I kept seeing references to this amazing tree that had been so important to the eastern United States. So when I found out 10 or 12 years ago that there was an organization on the verge of bringing the tree back, I just had to get involved. So what I want to do this evening is spend some time trying to impress upon you how important this tree was to the eastern United States, culturally, historically, economically, definitely. And then we'll get into what went wrong. How come we have almost lost this tree? And then we'll get into the good news about maybe we're on the verge of bringing it back. So the very first thing I want to clear up, though, is that we are not talking about the horse chestnut tree. The horse chestnut tree is a European species that was brought over here a long time ago. In fact, there's one growing in Portsmouth, New Hampshire, that was planted when the Declaration of Independence was signed. So the horse chestnut tree has been around that long, but it is not the tree we're talking about. And fortunately, I'm sure you're all familiar with the horse chestnut tree. You'll see this big flower structure in the springtime. And they're always out.
Can we dim the overhead lights a bit?
Okay, here we go. Okay. Okay. What we are talking about, though, is the American chestnut tree. This tree was native to the eastern United States. It grew to large sizes. It's related to the beech tree. You might recognize the leaf looks something like a beech tree, only it's larger. And I have leaf samples up here and some other things for you to look at. And by all means, come up when we're through and get familiar with those. When an American chestnut tree flowers, It's nothing like the horse chestnut tree. These little things up here about the size of the tip of your little finger, those are the flowers. And when they do flower, what you see primarily are the catkins, these strands that produce the pollen. And when the one does get pollinated and it develops, these little seed structures in here turn into pods about this burrs about the size of a tennis ball, maybe a little bit smaller, and inside each burr there are three nuts. So that's the difference between the horse chestnut and the American chestnut. The historic range extended all the way from Maine right down through Georgia and out toward the west, almost to the Mississippi River. About 200 million acres was dominated, literally dominated. It was a dominant tree in the Appalachians. 30 to 40% of the forest cover in the Appalachian Mountains were American chestnuts. We know they were here in New England. This is a particular tree. We just found this about a year and a half ago. It's just a remnant. This is just a little arc of the tree. That tree was probably at least 6 feet in diameter. And this was up in the White Mountains of New Hampshire, and just above the little town of Sandwich, if you're familiar with that area. The American chestnut tree has some really remarkable competitive advantages going for it. And I'll allude to those as we to these as we go along. This is one. I have this cross section right up here, so be sure and come see it later. But what this points out is that these trees are both shade tolerant and shade intolerant. Most plants either don't survive in shade or they won't survive in a lot of sunlight. This tree was 40 years old. Right here, and about 2 inches of the center, there are 25 growth rings because the tree was not getting shade, but it didn't die. It just sat there on the forest floor and waited. And then something happened to open up the canopy to the sunlight, and we've got 15 years of growth in that part of the tree. This was a 15-inch diameter tree, and they'll put on an inch of growth a year when the conditions are right. Well, let's get into some of the benefits that this tree provided. It was a huge tree, large, and I just point out it was fast growing. It could resist rot because it had a high tannin content. When it was sawn into boards, it rarely warped or split. It was fairly lightweight compared to oak. And again, when you come up later and you just lift this piece of wood, and you'll see how light it is compared to oak. Because it grows so fast, it's fairly porous. But still, it's remarkably strong, very strong. And a really interesting thing about, you know, how many trees provide a food source for people. It was an amazing wildlife food. I'll get into that later. We don't know how amazing it was, but we just know it certainly benefited wildlife. But it was a food source for people. You know, the chestnuts roasting on the open fire. This is what we're talking about. We know the Native Americans certainly realized its benefits. And I have not come across any specific Native American items that are made of American chestnut. But if any of you have, or you know, if you ever hear about that, I'd love to see those items and get some pictures of them. When the first white settlers came, they realized they had a very usable, abundant, and versatile building material. And Don, you actually found some buildings here, an array building here in Bedford that you know has American chestnut in it.
If many of you are familiar with Dudley Road, and Dudley Road in its glory was known as Chestnut Avenue, and the society has one of the old photographs looking up the Chestnut Avenue to the Pickman's House, the white column building. Just beyond that, in Billerica, there's a brick house. The barn that was attached to that house, the Pickmans converted to a library about the time the chestnut blight wiped out the chestnut trees. And Dudley Pickman had the barn now a library.
totally, completely furnished on the inside with chestnut. And of course, much later, David Pickman picked up the library house and moved it to the Bedford side of the line, so it's at, I think, 240 Dudley Road now. But that house is all chestnut finish on the inside. Also, one other thing, we do have one, Meg O'Shack mentioned that the Arbor Resources Committee here planted a few new chestnuts out on Carlisle Road by the DPW facility. One of them got eaten by deer, but one of them may still be surviving.
Very good. Very good. Okay. And I just can't imagine that some of these large old buildings here in Bedford don't have some chestnut beams in them or chestnut wood somewhere. The New Hampshire State House has chestnut and some of the finished wood, but unfortunately it's all been painted, so you don't even know it. If you drive along the Skyline Drive in North Carolina, you'll go by miles of these old split rail fences that have been there for 80, 90, 100 years. They're made of, most of them are made of American chestnut. That utility pole is down on Cape Cod, was put up in 1928, and it's still there, still being used, made of chestnut. I mentioned the tannin content. Tannin was used to make leather. Wood would be chipped up and boiled. That would extract the tannin from the wood, and then when you exposed hides to the tannin, it would replace the water that was in the hides, and that's how leather used to be made. And this mill was in Compton, North Carolina in the 1920s. It was using 100,000 cords of chestnut a year just to extract tannin. And then someone figured out that if they took that pulp after that tannin extraction, they could come up with a very porous, low-quality paper. How many remember when you were in grammar school, your teacher had the big green ink blotter on her desk? Those were most likely made from the pulp after tannin was extracted from chestnut. Furniture, it was used for this bed is in the Robert Frost farmhouse up in Derry, New Hampshire. Occasionally we come across pieces of furniture made with chestnut. Another thing that it was used a lot for, veneers. When veneer finish was put on certain wood, the base wood would often be chestnut. These little machinist tool chests were made down in Pawtucket, Rhode Island, sir.
What do you look for in the graining to identify it in furniture?
Come up afterwards and I'll give you a little hint. It's not easy. You can see it looks a lot like oak, but you can make chestnut look like oak, but it's hard to make oak look like chestnut. It's not, but there is a little trick you can sometimes use. I'll show you later. The U.S. Forest Service puts out a report every year on how different woods are used in each state. And I found this report from 1912, well over 100 years ago, how it was used in New Hampshire. A lot of it was used to build railroads and fences, furniture. Can anybody tell me what hames are? Usually I bring a set with me, but I forgot them. You know what, when you see a draft horse with a big collar around his neck, and right in front of the collar are these S-shaped pieces of wood with a piece of brass on the tip of it? Those are hames. And some folks told me that there used to be a mill up in Sunapee, New Hampshire that made hames. And I have a set, and I apologize, I forgot to bring the my grandfather used to use. I'm not sure they made a chestnut, but I wouldn't be surprised. But it was some of the old wooden ice boxes you see around. If you look real hard, occasionally you'll find one of those that are made out of chestnut. And the food source. The wagon loads of chestnuts used to be brought out of the Appalachian Mountains to Philadelphia, Baltimore in the fall and just roasted on the street corner and sold. And we know it was an extremely important wildlife food, but we don't know exactly how important it was because the study of wildlife science really didn't get going till the mid-1930s. And by then, the chestnuts were pretty much on the way out. So, but we do know that if we can bring this tree back and get it established in our forest, there's no question it'll benefit wildlife populations. John Eckley did this sketch to try to show how many different species in our forest depended on chestnuts, and he just got a little out of hand there, I think. I don't think he won any art contest, but his point is quite well taken. It was very important. Rita Blythe, a graduate student at the University of Indiana, has done this simple little study. She simply took and drilled these little holes in a board and put different kinds of wildlife food, acorns, beech nuts, chestnuts, black walnuts, and then she would just come back and see, well, what was disappearing first. And the first thing to go were the American chestnuts. And then the other things would be taken in time. The last thing to go, I can't tell you why, but the last thing to go were the black walnuts. There's just a couple left here, but everything else was gone before the black walnuts. So I don't know if you ever tried to open a black walnut, you'll know why. So all these benefits are gone. Everything I just described just doesn't happen anymore. And what went wrong? In 1904, at the New York Botanical Garden, the staff folks started to notice that their American chestnut trees were dying. They're dying rather quickly. It took a couple of years to figure out what was going on, and they realized that when we had imported some chestnut trees from Asia, the American chestnut is Castanea dentata. There was a tree brought in from Asia, Castanea mollissima, and with it came a fungus disease. And that became known, it was Cryphonectra parasitica, but the common name of it became chestnut blight. And what it does, it's a fungus growth, something like a mushroom. You know, when a mushroom reproduces, it just produces millions of these tiny, tiny spores that you can hardly see. And all you need is for one of those spores to get in a little crack in the bark or a fissure somehow, and it will just grow right around the circumference of the point of entry. And it just strangles the tree from that point of infection upstream. Keep that in mind, that upstream versus downstream thing, because that's a very important point that we'll get into in a few minutes. So that was the source of the loss. As I say, it was first noticed in 1904 in New York City. By 1950s, it had completely consumed the 200 million acres of the historic range, and it just decimated the tree. It just killed almost every one of them. So you can imagine the states and the U.S. Forest Service, every industry that depended on chestnut, tried everything they could to stop the blight. Just cut away dead trees, try to spray fungicides. And one thing that was tried, there was one attempt at crossbreeding, just to cross an American with a Chinese, hoping that the tree would resist the blight, but they were just as vulnerable as the wild chestnut trees. So you might say, well, if the Asian tree resists the blight, why don't we just let the Asian tree take over? Well, there's two problems with that. One is, and this is a full-grown Chinese chestnut tree. That's as big as they get. They don't have the stalled, say, trunk and the source of timber. And another thing is that they will not survive in our forests, fortunately. We don't know why, but they won't. They just need to be out in the open. So they're just no good as a replacement. So that's enough bad news. Let's get in to the good news. What's going on? Remember I said earlier that when the blight attacks a tree, it kills the tree from the point of infection up the tree. It doesn't kill the roots. And even in today, those roots still keep sending up these little shoots. How many of you have walked around Walden Pond? You know where the cabin, where Thoreau's cabin was? If you go there and look around, you will find quite a few wild American chestnuts. They don't get very big. A big one would be 5 or 6 inches in diameter before the blight kills them. So, and once you see a couple and know what you're looking for, you'll be surprised how many are still around. If you drive around this time of year, they're like beech trees and white oaks. They keep their leaves right through the winter, and you will see some now, this time of year, that these little sprigs will still be there, but and then you'll see new ones coming up, but the blight just keeps knocking them back. So one good thing, because of that, occasionally we find trees that live long enough to flower, 5 to 8 years. We call them mother trees in the chestnut world, chestnut restoration world. So that's one thing. We'll get back to this also, that the tree is still there. Even though we think the blight has wiped it out, it has not completely left us. All right, the other fortunate thing that happened was that Dr. Charles Burnham, who was a plant pathologist at the University of Minnesota, spent his career genetically creating disease-resistant agricultural crops for the Great Plains. After he retired, he and one of his cohorts, Philip Rutter, for some reason, they were out in Minnesota. They weren't even within the historic range of the American chestnut tree. But for some reason, they got interested, and they wondered why nobody had ever tried to do genetic backcrossing with the chestnut tree. So in 1983, they formed the American Chestnut Foundation, and they started doing this a genetic backcrossing process. So what's that all about? All right, this is the heart of what the Chestnut Foundation has done and is still doing. I already said that historically there had been a cross between the Chinese tree and the Asian tree. That in geneticist terms, that would be an F1 generation. That's as far as anyone went until Dr. Burnham came along. What he did, he took this F1 and got pollen from another wild American and crossed it. So then he had a tree that was 3/4 American. Then he did it again. He took the BC1, pollinated again, got a BC2. So he had a tree that was 7/8 American. Then he went the next step, and he had a tree. Now I have to go the next step here. So when he got to the BC3 generation, he had a tree that was 15/16. Then he started crossing two BC3 together to get the BC3F2. So he's got a 15/16, a tree that has 15/16 of the American chestnut qualities. But what he would do at each of these generations is intentionally inoculate those trees with the chestnut blight when they got to be 4 or 5 inches in diameter. And most of those trees would die. The point was he was looking for the strongest trees among those different generations. And he would take the strongest one, by strong I mean the most blight resistant, and use those to pollinate to go to the next generation. And the really good news is that this is where we are right now. In 2008, we have a research station in Meadowview, Virginia, that produced the first of the 6th generation trees, which we hope can resist the blight. So, most of this work was done at our small research station in Meadowview, Virginia, where thousands of these trees have been planted over the years. And what, if you go there today, you'll see the few remaining ones that are most resistant to the blight from each of the various generations. And most of this work was done by Dr. Fred Hebbard. He's been working there for the last 25 years. He just recently retired. but the work will certainly continue. So let's review the situation. We've got a little research farm, 150 acres in Meadowview, Virginia, that has developed, we hope, the blight-resistant tree, but we want to restore it to 200 million acres of former habitat. Well, how do you do that? You do that by creating chapters in each of the states where the tree was native and have those chapters duplicate what was done at Meadowview. So what Lois and Dennis have been involved in, what I've been involved in, and by the way, my wife Carol is back there. She's heavy into this thing too. We're duplicating what was done at Meadowview. So we have gone out and we have found mother trees, the trees that have lived long enough in the wild before the blight gets them. We go to those trees and we pollinate them, and we start with the third generation of the pollen that we get from Meadowview, and then we harvest the nuts for those trees and plant them in various orchards. So that's what we call controlled pollination, and that's how this happens. We find a mother tree, these little things are the flowers. We go to those trees in the early June, usually, early to mid-June, they're late blooming trees, which is another competitive advantage they have. They don't bloom till well after the threat of frost. So you don't get a lot of fluctuation in their production because almost every crop in the natural environment would survive. So we go to the trees, we cut the catkins away because we don't want them to get pollinated with anything else, put them in these little bags, and then we come back, we let the flowers open up inside the bags, come back in a week or 10 days and literally hand pollinate them with fourth generation pollen, and then we let them mature and harvest them in the late September, early October. This is a tree that we found in Hudson, New Hampshire, where I live.
My question, sir, is it self-pollinization or is it cross-pollinization?
Is it what?
Self-pollinization or cross-pollinization?
The tree in nature, you mean? No, you need it. It's monoecious. You need two, three. They will not pollinate themselves. Is that your question? No, you need two trees. Okay. This is a tree we found in Hudson, New Hampshire. And in fact, this cross section I have up here came from this tree. In 2010, we found this tree. It was 65 feet tall, 15 inches in diameter. We just found it like weeks before a developer was going to go in there and start working in that area. He was very cooperative, let us go in and pollinate the tree. We got 194 viable nuts off of that tree. And incidentally, when we do this, we find utility companies extremely cooperative. Used to be called Public Service of New Hampshire, now it's called Eversource. They just really come forward and help us with bucket trucks. Otherwise, we just couldn't get up there and do this. So this tree was pollinated in 2010, got 194 nuts off it. We were all excited about going back the next year. We went back and the tree was dead. Just like that. That's how fast the blight can kill one of these trees. And you'll see it gets in under the bark, down low, and it just strangled the tree. That was the second largest tree that we knew of in Vermont, New Hampshire. And the largest one, which is in Berlin, Vermont, 2 years ago, that died also. Fortunately, the landowner was very cooperative. He let us take the tree. We had it sawn into some boards, and we're using those boards now to make some items that we can auction off for fundraising. A woodworker named Dave Kucher up in Ware, New Hampshire, made this table for us. He actually put a little hand-inlaid chestnut leaf in it. We did use this to raise some money, and we just last fall gave this tree as a wedding present to our science coordinator, Kendra Collins now. Her name was Kendra Gurney. So that's in her home now. So anyway, the trees, the nuts from that tree.
How long is a generation for a chestnut tree?
How many, what?
How long is a generation for a chestnut?
5 to 8 years.
Can you repeat the question, please?
Oh, yeah. He wanted to know how long a generation was. In other words, how long does it take one to flower? Yeah, 5 to 8 years under good conditions. When we see these, when we take the nuts from, for instance, from the tree in Hudson, they were put in an orchard up in Perkinsville, Vermont, called Pike's Peak, and these get very good care. We water them and fertilize them, keep records on them, and that's what, in 2014, that's what one of the trees was looking like up there. But we do keep very good records. This is an orchard that our Vermont, New Hampshire chapter has in Peterborough. If you're familiar with Peterborough and the Shieling State Forest, you just pull right into the parking lot and you'll see the orchard right there. Those trees will probably be inoculated next growing season. In fact, we're going to be up there in the next week or two doing some maintenance to see how they're doing.
Are they deer-proof?
Deer love them. You have to, you can see it. We've got a fence around. You have to get a fence around them. The deer love them. So this is what we call a breeding orchard. It's the first orchard that we put in. This tree was pollinated with generation 4 pollen, so it's going to produce generation 5 nuts. We then take those nuts and put them in what we call a seed orchard. Now here's where the Massachusetts chapter is ahead of our Vermont, New Hampshire chapter. The Massachusetts chapter already is into the seed orchard stage. We haven't put one of these in yet in Vermont, New Hampshire. These are very intensive. We plant 3,000 trees in one orchard and ultimately keep 20 of them. I'm not going to get into the details of that because it gets complicated, but if anybody really wants to know, you can talk to Lois or Dennis or myself and we can help explain it to you. But that's the process. So this is where the Mass Rhode Island chapter is. This orchard is a couple of years old now. It'll probably be another 6 or 8 before you actually get to getting those ideal 6th generation nuts out of it. How many remember Benson's Wild Animal Farm up in Hudson, New Hampshire? That is now a town park. And we have 8 of the 6th generation trees growing up there. They were put in 2011, and some of them are doing very well. We've got one that's almost as tall as this ceiling, that fast. And we have others that are about that tall. So no guarantees, but we're pretty optimistic. This is a map showing where the different orchards are in Mass. Well, it shows Mass, Connecticut, and Rhode Island. But if you want to, maybe we can talk, Lois and Dennis, if somebody really wants to track some of those down, we can put this slide back up. And Dennis and Lois can probably help explain where they are and what the stage of each orchard is. But you can see there's quite a few of them. So it's a big job. So that's the story about, just a second. That's the story of how important we thought this tree was and what went wrong. And hopefully we're on the track to bring it back. And if we're very much a volunteer organization. I mentioned Kendra Collins. She's the only paid employee we have for all the New England chapters. She works with Maine, Vermont, New Hampshire, Mass, Rhode Island, Connecticut. She's a busy lady, but she does a wonderful job for her, and that's her right there. So we're very much volunteer dependent, and we're always looking to get new members, and that's the best way to stay abreast of how things are progressing. There's an application form in your brochure. If you want to become a member, you can join online. Our webpage is acf.org, where you can get a lot more information. You'll get our, we have a journal that comes out every couple months that tells you what's going on. And I've got a couple of really good books up here, too, that tell you the whole story. You might want to come up and look at those. So that's where we are. These are the key people in Massachusetts. Yvonne is the president of the Mass Rhode Island chapter, and her contact information is in your handout also. So that's the story, and I had a question here already.
The question I have is, does this tree and your seedlings require a particular type of soil that encourages growth?
Okay, the question was, what kind of soil do they prefer? They like a well-drained, slightly acidic 4.5 to 6 pH, similar to what blueberries like. That's the type of soil they like. They're very resilient, though. They'll grow in quite a few different environments, but that's the preferred. So, okay, we got any more questions? Yes, Carol.
It's amazing. You mentioned that you're a volunteer organization. You didn't say anything, and my question is there any involvement by any agencies of the federal government? Because this is such a massive task, and you need money. Do they help out at all, or are they doing similar things?
Okay, the question was, what agencies are helping us? We get a lot of help from agents. Kendra is stationed at the U.S. Forest Service Research Station in Burlington, Vermont. The head of that lab is on our on our board of directors. The Forest Service really didn't. They didn't that time. The Forest Service puts a big ad in every one of our magazines. No, they are very, very much involved. The National Park Service has planted 3,000 of the sixth generation trees at the Flight 93 Memorial in Shanksville, Pennsylvania. The Interior Department is doing a lot of work with reclaimed strip mines in five different states, from Indiana to Maryland. Our orchard in Peterborough is at a state forest. So yes, that's a long answer to your question, but yes, a lot of agencies are very, very supportive.
To answer the question, I do think DCR in Commonwealth of Massachusetts, last September I found two of them. I had notified the University of Mass and Amherst about it. Make sure the verification of the tree was definitely an American chestnut. This is where the tornado went through and devastated, because when I was out there, I thought, oh my God, the clear cut they did. They totally destroyed it. But I was able to find two American chestnuts in this spring. They are going to be cross-pollinating them with the Department of Resources.
Okay, thank you very much. Yes? They look the same. Well, hopefully they will look the same. You know, the oldest ones are only 8 years old. So, but so far they look very much like American chestnut trees. Yes?
I have been told that Sanders Theater at Harvard, which is a venue very popular for a lot of events, many people know it, that's entirely American chestnut. Do you know if that's true?
I don't know. What's the name of the facility in Harvard?
Sanders Theater.
Sanders Theater.
Our Memorial Church.
Oh, you mean the building is made of chestnut? Is that
no,
what you mean?
The interior of the theater is paneled.
Is paneled in chestnut. I don't know, but I'll certainly find out. I do know there's a... in Buffalo, New York, there's a mansion that's entirely filled with chestnut. Campobello up at the Roosevelt Summer Place has a lot of chestnut finished wood in it. So, it was very, very popular because it was so abundant. So, I'm surprised there's not more of it very visible. Sir?
Is there any
What was the longevity of chestnuts before the blight?
The longevity, probably 600 or 700 years. 6-8 foot diameter chestnut trees right around here were not uncommon. I mean, they were huge, and they lived for just centuries. Yes.
How much, if you're going to plant some of these, how much space do they want? If you're going to plant 10 of the seedlings, how far apart, and you need a, how high of a fence around them?
Well, you need, it depends. The ones we planted at Benson Park in Hudson, there's 8 trees spread over about 3 or 4 acres. So they're really spread apart because we just had a lot of land to work with and we only had 8 trees. When we plant them in our breeding orchards, we put them about 8 feet apart, but we're only going to keep those trees till they get 10 or 12 years old. So if you want to plant one and 80, 100 years from now, you want a big, beautiful chestnut tree, you better get them quite a distance apart. Maybe Dennis or Lois could help you with that specific question. I really don't know. They're big trees. If they survive for a century or two, they're going to be huge. So
you sound like you're not optimistic. Anything is going to last longer than 15 years, though.
Oh, we think they're going to, we hope we've done it, that they're going to keep on going. You know, the wild trees, no, they don't. We know that they're going to die, but the ones that we've back crossed, we're hoping that they're going to be able to survive the blight.
Again, if you want to get maximum production, you'd probably put 50 feet apart for maximum nut production to get a good canopy.
Okay, did you, 50 feet? 50 feet's a good rule of thumb, I guess, according to Lois, so, yeah. Carol?
Don't keep all the trees that you're planting. Do you give the ones, you don't kill them?
Yes, we do.
Can't you give them away? I mean, I take a tree and put it in my yard and hope and pray that it would live.
No, because we don't, we want to keep control of this thing. We don't want a tree over here that might make it, but it's not really a, we know that it was affected by the blight, so no, we don't keep them. Okay, well, thank you very much for your attention, and Carol and Lois and Dennis and I will be around to answer your questions. And oh, and incidentally, I was given a check by Rob earlier, and we're going to make sure that the Bedford Historic Society becomes a member of the Chestnut Foundation. So.